Welcome, everybody. We are going to start in just a minute or two. Thank you for being here. A lot of people signed up for this, so we're going to let just a few more enter the room. So you have time to get a glass of water. I always feel like there should be elevator music when this happens.
Music to grow by.
Loretta, while we're waiting for some people to join, let's talk about how many avocado trees we've killed. I personally have killed, I think, 3, and that's why I need this class so desperately.
Well, I killed 3 on my first planting of 6. Only 3 made it, 3 died. That was about 12 years ago. And then waited for avocado bearing. So then I decided I need to learn a little more. Then I planted about another 6, lost. No, I planted 8, lost 2. And then I currently have about a dozen in pots on my driveway that I transplanted. I figured for me, it's easier to transplant out of the little sleeves that they tend to come in when you get them at a nursery into 5-gallon pots into this good gritty mix that they like. Because, you know, you keep them a little too long in the pot, you get that root rot, they die in the pot. So I put them in there to wait till the weather's right to get them in the ground. And it gets them a little bigger. I like them a little bigger in the ground. When they're those tiny little sleeves, you really have to care for them. Protect them and from sun and cold and to get them to grow. And they do, but like I say, I don't have the greatest record. So now with my newer method, get them a little bigger by caring for them in a bigger pot with better soil. I think, and knowing what I do now, I think I should be a lot better.
Well, that's great. We are going to hear all that again. We are just spending some time waiting for people to join. We had quite a response to this class. It's very exciting. This is Loretta Heath, and my name is Delise Weir. And you are here for the UCSC Farm and Garden Growing Avocados on the Central Coast, co-sponsored by the UC Master Gardeners of Santa Cruz and Monterey Counties. People are still joining, but let's get going anyway. So like I said, I'm Delise. This is Loretta. Can we move to the next slide, please? All right. Now, if we didn't learn about Zoom during COVID, I don't know where we were. But I'll just mention that in this evening session, we're going to ask you to mute your microphone and turn your video off. That's so that the bandwidth doesn't get all eaten up. Speaker view in the upper right-hand corner is recommended. That way you'll know who's talking as things go on. Use your chat window for questions and comments to the group. And enter your questions as you go. As you think of them, please enter them at the end of the one-hour lecture portion. We will feed questions back to Loretta. I will keep track of them and get them answered as well as we can, depending on how many questions we get. There is a CC live script button. That means that you can get closed captioning if you have trouble hearing the audio. So that's a convenient thing to have. You have to click the button on the bottom of your screen. If you're having issues with and need technical assistance, you want to chat to our host, Kiana, who is on the call. So find under participants her name. It's actually, Kiana, are you there as that or are you there as Center for Agroecology host?
Me, I'm here with Center of Agroecology.
All right, so that's where Kiana is. If you have any issues, that's how you would get to her. And then after this class, and I'll say this several times, we are going to send you the presentation, and we're going to send you a link to the video in your email and any other resources that come up. So Don't fear, don't have to take copious notes. You're going to get all the information afterwards. Next, please. Alrighty, so this is sponsored by the Friends of the UCSC Farm and Garden. We are a support group that supports the Center for Agroecology, which is also known as the Farm and Garden up there at the university. We work with the staff to do fundraising and public outreach and ad hoc support for programs as needs arise. As a community member, your very best way to get an inside view on what's going on at the Center for Ag or Center for Agroecology is to become a member. And there are lots of perks to becoming a member. You get a discount at garden centers in Santa Cruz, several of them. You get early entry to our plant sale in the spring. You're invited to special events that nobody else can come to. You get a special newsletter. All kinds of fun things happen when you are a member. So if you want to become a friend, I will add that link to the chat in just a moment because I can't talk and do two things at the same time. When you get this presentation, you will be able to click on that directly. Next slide, please. So thank you to the Friends for the sponsorship. And this is the first time we have done a collaboration like this. It's co-sponsored by the UC Master Gardeners of Monterey and Santa Cruz. Now, they're both united by the UC. The University of California is an umbrella. They're in sort of different branches of that, but we do similar things. So the Master Gardeners are an all-volunteer organization that provides all-access gardening classes taught by volunteers. They have a hotline for any garden question you might have, which can be very convenient if you have bugs or issues or any kind of question. They will do the research and do their best to get back to you. They hold special events and, like I said, work classes and workshops, and they also have plant sales. So the way you can find out more about them is to subscribe at mbmg.ucanr.edu to be on their newsletter, and then you will get a monthly update on what they're got going on. So earlier, when folks were just coming in, we were talking about all the avocado trees that we've grown and killed. I've done at least three. It's very expensive. And I've learned so much just from looking at the slides that Loretta Heath here has created that you guys are in luck because you don't have to spend all that extra money. So Loretta, take it away. Tell us all about yourself.
Welcome, everybody. I'm so happy to be here. I hope I can help you with your avocado, be more successful with avocados than I was when I first started planting them. I've killed more than my fair share, and have done since then, did a lot of research and took classes, and so hopefully, we will be able to help you be a better avocado grower. So it's a little bit about my background. I am a UC Master Gardener. I retired several years ago and started working at a nursery. I just realized my calling, or in my retired years, I just really wanted to get better at growing plants on my property here and trees and edibles. And so I started taking classes. And so now I have a little ranchette with a lot of citrus and avocado, stone fruit, nut trees, and livestock, most of which consists of a good sized herd of Gloucestershire Old Spots pigs. So I'm kind of attached to those pigs. And so I really like to help you solve your life. I really like to help you solve your gardening issues, gardening problems. And I like to learn from people I talk to about what they've learned on how to solve the gardening issues and stuff. So it's a mutual relationship with gardening. You're always learning, right? You never learn at all. Okay, so here's what we'll cover today. We're going to cover about the varieties of avocados that grow well in our cool, foggy summer climate. That's a major issue with, you got to start out with one that you know will succeed here. And then how to care for it once you get it, how to plant it, watering and fertilizing, when to pick the fruit, which can be tricky. And they're susceptible to certain pests and diseases, nothing too bad, but they are susceptible to certain things. And then where you can go to get extra help. Here's some of the basics about avocado trees. They're made of two parts. They're grafted. So they have the top fruiting portion, what we call the scion, is selected for its flavor, how abundantly it produces, the ripening times, its tolerance to heat and cold. And they are genetic clones of a mother plant from which they were cut. So that graft, when if this tree is in its infancy, it's grafted onto a rootstock. And that rootstock is an avocado, a different variety, and it's chosen for its disease resistance, its soil adaptability, its vigor, cold hardiness, salt tolerances, et cetera. So there, and the rootstocks, they come from clones or from seeds. So just know that sometimes you'll buy a little avocado tree and you'll see this big weird thing at the base of it, and it's the split seed that was the rootstock. There's a little bit about the basics of avocados, their origins. They originated in the tropical areas of South Central Mexico and South America. So I thought it was really cool that the oldest records of human consumption come from the Mexican state of Puebla back 10,000 years. And there's evidence that they domesticated 4,000 to 3,000 years BC. And currently, commercial avocado growing in the US is centered around the Southern Central California. 90% of what the US grows comes from central on down to Southern California, with the remainder grown in Florida and a little in Hawaii. And, you know, we don't have that climate, that heat and the dryness in the spring that Central and Southern California has. But if we choose varieties carefully, we can be successful with many good varieties of avocado in our cool, foggy, cool summer Monterey Bay area or coastal area. And maybe you're a little cooler because you're in some of the mountains around here too. So we'll look at varieties for that too. Where are you going to put this avocado? Okay, so they need a warm, sunny location that has a minimum of 6 hours of mostly full sun. And they'll also tolerate some filtered light, especially when they're little. They start growing in the wild. They're understory trees, so they're kind of shaded out a little bit even, but mostly full sun. Especially when young, they will tolerate a little more shade. Avoid low spots where you know on your property that cold and frost pockets are known to settle. Avoid those areas. And if you have direct wind, salty ocean wind, they're not going to do well. It's going to blow the leaves right off. So try to find an area that's sheltered from winds. The other thing about avocados, they can get really huge. They just keep growing, and they can get 30 to 50 feet tall and wide without any pruning, of course. So plan accordingly. I've seen some planted 2 feet away from a house or a fence, and that's really not going to, you're going to end up pruning so hard to maintain that distance away from a structure like that, that just start with having enough room for the tree. And you can, through pruning, keep the tree 10 to 12 foot tall, and even that wide or even less. There are many folks that keep their trees 6 to 8 foot wide because they want to have a lot of them on a small property. So with judicious pruning, you can keep them smaller, but just know that they want to be big. They can grow in a wide range of soils, but the most important thing is that soil has to drain well. Heavy clay soils are a problem, but there are planting techniques you can use if you have a heavy soil. So you can be successful, but you're going to have to do something, put in some extra elbow grease at planting time. And, you know, when you go down south, Southern California, Central California, you see these slopes just covered with these trees. And they like the slopes. Slopes tend to drain well. And that soil happens to have a lot of rock and decomposed granite in it. And that makes the soil nice and gritty and well draining. So that's why they're successful in those warm slopes of Southern California. Choosing a tree. So choose a variety that's suitable for your climate and yard space. That's where you start. And look at the tree. they may have, you know, mottled trunks or something, or brown on the branches. Don't select anything that looks like it may already be starting with having a problem. So you get a nice green trunk, nice smooth green branches and green leaves. And some of these may be very young. It's just a little yearling, a sapling. And so it may not have a whole lot of leaves, but that's how they're sold. There, a lot of them are sold in these little sleeves, small pots. You'll find some in 5 gallons and 3 gallons, but a lot of them are in these little sleeves, which is fine. You just have to give them a little more care because they're young. So here's a table of varieties, and there are jillions of varieties of avocados. What I looked at here is I looked at people who grow locally, people who've posted about varieties that bear well locally and taste good, and that's what I included in this list. So you can see I had the variety, a little bit of information on temperature, and that is what they can tolerate. Because, you know, as a tree that evolved in the tropics, the majority of the really excellent flavored ones, they don't want a whole lot of frost. So anything below 30 degrees may damage them, especially when they're little. So we have a little temperature gauge here. And just a kind of a little a description about the flavor. Flavor is subjective, but your typical bumpy Hass avocado that you're finding in the markets right now, that's what I'm calling excellent. It's that buttery standard of excellence that we all want to grow. So that's excellent. And then there's some that do very well here because they're cold tolerant, like the Zutano and the Bacon and the Scythix Mexicola. It can take a lot of cold. You sacrifice flavor for the cold tolerance here. So just know that. And this size has to do with the natural growth habits and size of these trees, which mostly are large, but there have been some trees developed that grow smaller and don't grow as large. So you will have a lot less pruning to do on something like a Gem or a Gwen or a Lamb Hass. And the order I wanted to do alphabetical. I thought, no, I'm going to do it in order of when they ripen. So if you want to pick a couple of trees, you can maybe pick one from the upper half of this chart and from the lower half. So you can get some overlap in a longer fruiting season. So that's the order I chose. And that's kind of when they ripen here. When you buy an avocado, it has a label on it and it may say when it ripens, or you may look up when it ripens. That ripening time period is gonna be for Southern California or Central California in prime avocado country. And they start ripening earlier there because of their warm, dry springs. Their bloom time is a little earlier and they ripen sooner. So we will ripen a little later, just know that. But the benefit is they may hang a little longer here because our summers are cooler than Southern California. So that fruit can hang a little longer too on the tree. So it's a good thing. And then these notes, read through them. Something like this Carmen, it's good to know. It has a very special second bloom here where it evolved in Michoacan. It has almost a continuous bloom there. In Southern California, there's folks that report 3 or 4 distinct bloom periods for it. I've only reporting what I have seen with my little tree here the first few years that I've had it, and I get a second bloom in the fall. So you can see there's a potential for a year-round crop with that Carmen, and it's tasty too. So read the notes. One thing to note, like look at this Gwen, it's small. People want small trees for their yards, but it's possibly self-infertile, meaning just by itself, you may not get a whole lot of fruit. So it needs another one close by, and that close by tree shouldn't be one of its own offspring that these Gem and Surprise. So any other tree within 50 feet other than these two, you're probably going to get a really good fruit set, and it's excellent fruit. And it's a naturally smaller tree. So let's move on.
Hey Loretta.
Yes.
We have a few questions that were applicable to that slide. Can I just throw them out there?
Yeah. Yes.
So one person recommended a variety that's not on your list. It's called the Holiday Worst WURST, dwarf tree. Got yummy fruit. It's 8 to 10 feet. Have you heard of that one?
Yes, I have heard of that one. It's tasty. There were two little small ones. I'm wondering if that's one I didn't put on here because do they know that it bears well here? Because it is sold here. And there are others sold here too that don't bear, but there was holiday and Wurtz little. Oh, because there are two. Wurtz is the one you see an alias for called little cotto or dwarf avocado. That's Wurtz and little cotto. And holiday is a different variety. And holiday may bear a little better here. I think from other presentations I've seen locally, the little cotto Wurtz that's sold a lot doesn't bear all that. Or as well as they claim here in our climate. So I will look up the holiday, and if it's good, adequate fruit set here, then I'll add it to the list. And we can get that person's name and let them know. But both of those were kind of.
So Mandy says
Pardon?
it does. She's gotten a few every year, so I don't know if that's
Oh,
good
good.
fruit set.
Hi, Mandy.
But I've
Okay.
got some other questions here
Okay.
about varieties. So multi-grafting, is that a thing? Can you do that?
You can do that if you're good at grafting. You just it's a little funny. You have to be careful. It's not like when you can multigraft a stone fruit. It's grafting. Avocados take to grafting very well. I know of people who have multigrafts. What the big thing you have to be careful of is the branch you do choose to graft on. You have to make sure it's clear of all other growth. And the avocado wants to put all its energy into growing itself and not that little graft you stick onto it. So you have to eliminate, it'll try shooting out all these other sprouts and stuff. So you have to pay attention and don't just leave the graft there because if other growth comes out underneath it, it'll kind of sap strength from it. So with care, yeah, there's people who do multigrafting. But it's not as easy as a stone fruit multigraft, a fruit cocktail, peach tree, plum tree, that sort of thing.
Okay, we have one person who's going to have to leave early, and
Okay.
she really, really wants to know. She wants a short tree, and she wants to know. Let's see. Let me find her again. Should it be pruned? How do you prune it to limit the size and maximize the fruit production? She understands that bloom happens on new wood and wonders, do you have advice?
My advice is so wait after your last frost date in the late winter, early spring. Because you may have to be doing some pruning anyway to cut off frostbite. So don't prune before then. Leave it so that there's more protection through that time period. Then after that, look and see where you want to prune. The other thing about avocados, it's not like pruning a rose where you prune to a node, and so the sprout comes out there. It can sprout from anywhere on a branch or the trunk even. They top these trees and they just sprout up from the trunk. So prune to maintain size, being careful that if you do, it can handle hard cutting because they're very vigorous. Once you get your tree grown, get that little tree grown, don't prune it hardly at all when it's first 2, 3 years. Don't do it. Get it grown bigger. And when you do prune, if you cut something off that's going to leave a big hole, you cut off a lot of the shade, you may need to protect that area, the exposed limb or the exposed trunk, with some whitewash. You're sunscreening it to avoid sunburn because they are very susceptible, especially if you're going to do some hard pruning. You might want to just whitewash a little bit, and that's in the presentation. You also can prune to a side branch. And if you do your typical collar prune where there's that little raised collar that you cut off, that collar will heal over just like it does like on a stone fruit. And then you may get what you wanted and it sprouts right below your cut. But I show two pictures in the example where in one case it did do that. And in the other case, the sprout was way lower and it shot off a really vigorous sprout, not where you wanted it to come out. But that's an avocado. Did that
Okay,
answer?
that was great. We are getting a bunch of questions that I know you're going to answer, so let's let you go do your thing.
Okay. Yeah, we'll get into pruning, and I'll show you a few pictures and how to protect during pruning and everything. So these instructions, if you're going to plant in, you have well-draining soil. I happen to have sand here, so I haven't dealt with a lot of the issues other people do. But your typical, dig your hole 2 to 3 times as wide as the existing pot. Or if you're planting in a sleeve, then at least 18, planting a sleeve at least 18 inches wide. This is a little narrow sleeve that I was talking about. And deep enough for just the top of the root ball to be about an inch above ground level. The avocado's roots are in, most of them when they're growing are in the top foot. They go down a little bit, 16, 18 inches, but the majority of the way it grows are in the top foot of the tree. And after we plant this, we're gonna mulch to cover the top of that root ball to keep it cool and airy up there. So you plant them a little high. The roots are very sensitive. Don't do any massaging like we do with a lot of shrubs and trees and stuff to break up that overgrown root ball. Don't do that at all. Treat them very delicately. They're brittle and sensitive. So just, you hold it in your hand and even cut the sleeve away rather than try to pull it. And gently position the tree in the hole and hold it while you're cutting away that plastic pot or sleeve. And that's the time to add a stake, if it doesn't have one already, that extends at least a foot or two above the tree. That stake is gonna not only help the little tree in winds, but it's also gonna help possibly hold shade cloth or frost blanket or something like that. And you can put other stakes in afterward too, but I recommend you keep the little stake that may have come with it just for a while, and you can loosen the connections to that stake so it's not just bound really tightly. Give it a little slack. Then backfill with your native soil. Don't amend. You had good, well-draining soil. Just use the native soil. And again, leave that inch of root ball. And you see this, what he did up here, made this little tank. When you first plant this tree, all the roots are in that little pot shape or sleeve shape here. And so you want to guide your water to that center spot. So a little tank helps that. And you fill it up with water, it makes it easy for the water to go in. If you put it on a drip system, that's great too. But start it off with your drip emitter or micro sprinkler right at the root, the little root ball. And then in a few months, you can move it outward as your tree is growing. But start everything to water those roots right there. There's great success with adding gypsum to the top. Just the top, don't mix it in, of your planting. Gypsum is a calcium compound. It's basically what's in drywall. And it has a lot of benefits for avocados. It kind of helps with repel fungus that the avocado can be prone to. It can break up heavier soils and help with drainage. And it adds some nutrient, it adds some calcium to the soil too. So I recommend adding that. I didn't know anything about that at first. So my new plantings are gonna have it. And here's the really important part. Add a couple inches of mulch. Most people use a wood chip mulch. Don't put compost, fine compost. You want an airy, chunkier wood chip mulch, several inches. I see some people do a whole foot or bigger, but a few inches minimum. Avocado trees love to be mulched. Those roots like the coolness. It drains well, but it stays kind of moist for a while. And so put your wood chip mulch on top. Here's how you can see it. And you can build forms like they did here. Some people do really elaborate stone forms or wooden forms. This is just a wire, it's like a reinforcing wire, a fencing wire basket to hold all that mass in. So here's now this, why this is even higher. This planting method is if you have a heavy clay soil, it's death to an avocado. They need to have the airspace and the drainage, the quick drainage. So you plant, you elevate it, you plant it on a mound, and people do it. It's a lot more work, but if you're set on having an avocado and you don't have the greatest draining soil, lift it, plant it on a mound. And this mound is going to have a gritty, well-draining soil and mix and some of your native soil in there. I recommend a bag soil like a cactus mix. They have a lot of sand and perlite pumice in it, so they drain very well. And or I have a recipe later for a homemade what they call a gritty mix to plant your tree. And so you're basically gonna, and you may go 3 to 5 foot wide, 1 to 2 foot tall. That if your tree is really tiny, maybe just start by it with a 1 foot mound and a 3 foot wide, you know, 3 foot wide, 1 foot tall. Or you may just go a whole hog right at first and do a 5 foot wide mound and go 2 foot tall. But just be careful. I don't think you need to go overboard with a little tree at first. But that mound is going to have the gritty mix underneath, and you're still going to mound a lot of a wood chipped airy mulch over it, and add your gypsum to that too. And you're probably going to have some sort of a drip or a micro sprinkler, so that mound is going to dry out quicker than the in-ground planted tree. So make sure you watch the moisture level of that newly planted, that mound and your tree. Any questions on that mound?
We got a question about growing in sand. You talked about growing in clay.
I just plant in ground, and I just put a tank around my tree because I have sand. And so I just plant with a root ball just a little bit inch above, put my tank in, put my wood chips. And now I'm going to start adding gypsum. I have about another dozen trees, little baby trees to plant. And so they're all going to get gypsum. I've never used it before, but I've seen a lot of the really successful growers use it at planting time here locally.
So a couple other questions. On a well-draining steep slope of clayey soil, is it good to add compost to the planting hole?
Don't, no, stay away from compost, especially. I mean, I know your slope drains well, but don't put any compost in your, just still use your native soil, keep your slope, and, try to back level a little bit so you have at least at first with your baby tree, it kind of has a little bit of a level. I have some on a slope and I kind of cut back and move the soil forward, cut back, so that at least starting out, it's a little bit flatter so I could still water in a tree ring. Did you say you were doing a mound and a slope because your soil is heavy? Or you're not knowing whether you should do a mound because you have a slope, a steep slope?
He didn't say a mound, but he said, should I add compost when I plant to
No.
a clay field site?
Still mulch it. Use your native soil. Back cut a little bit and that take that loose soil forward. You're adding a lot of air at the time. If you do add anything, add gritty mix like a cactus blend that has it may have a little bit of an organic, either a peat or a wood, composted wood product in it, but it has a lot of sand, perlite and peat in those cactus succulent blends. So if anything, you could put a little bit of that in there, but keep it a smaller percentage. Don't put over 30%. You're still going to get your tree growing in native soil, and you have the aid of that slope to help you with drainage. And then you're going to mulch on top, and the roots, as long as you maintain your watering without overwatering, the roots will find their place under that mulch and then on that mound, that slope to grow.
And can you talk about, we have two gypsum questions. One is it possible to substitute oyster shell instead of gypsum?
Don't know, I can look that up. They're two different compounds though. Oyster shell is I used to know, calcium carbonate. I think gypsum is more like, there's calcium sulfate. That's gypsum, calcium sulfate. It's a different compound than oyster shell. They're not the same thing. Use the calcium sulfate for the soil, for the properties that break up heavy soils and repel fungus. That's gypsum, calcium sulfate, because I think it's the sulfur property that's the repellent to fungus. Okay.
And then how much gypsum per tree do you have?
I said 10 plus pounds. I saw some people say 15. I saw some people say 5. So I split it, put 10 plus pounds. You can start smaller and you can add it on the top every year, or you can add, if you see success with it, you can add more gypsum later. But I put in the notes here, 10 plus pounds.
And if you have the luxury to be picky about your wood chips, is there a particular type of wood that's better than another? Oak, pine, walnut, redwood.
Just as long as it came from, you know, a healthy, if you know the source of it, if it came from, we always want healthier tree. I don't want something that came with from oleanders because of my dogs. And I don't want something that has, we have this phobia about eucalyptus, but I think that's kind of overblown. I don't think that's too much of an issue. The smaller pieces that are sharp cut that came from a better quality chipper, I love those because I use those in a lot of other places too. Sometimes I get stuff dumped from people who give me free and it's really shreddy. You know, their chipper was not the sharpest thing. And maybe it was a chipper that could do really bigger branches. So it ends up pounding and shredding more than chipping. Still works, but you know, the nice smaller chips look better. And where I've gotten the better chips seems to me, I've gotten them at the dump out in going towards Monterey, the Marina transfer station. They make it out of clean lumber, I believe, is where their wood chips come from. And then I pick up free chips at the local fire department here in Aromas. It's a little more shreddy, but that's where I get the majority of stuff. And I use those in my animal pens, on the trees, paths and stuff where I want to suppress weeds. So if you had your druthers, a pretty chip that came from cured lumber. But if it's just a natural stuff that comes from a pruner or a tree person, ask them of the source of the tree and ask them, would they mulch their own plants in their yard?
Okay. On you go, my dear.
So there's a lot of questions about growing in pots. And, you know, you'd think being these roots are so sensitive to compaction and overwatering that it's antithesis to growing in a pot. You know, a lot of the tree vendors that sell these avocados, they sell them in a 24-inch wooden crate, been in there for several years to get that big. It has fruit on it. So you can grow them in a pot. Just be sure, again, it's vital that you use a gritty mixed soil, like a pure cactus blend. Don't mix it with an organic or this. Use a gritty mix that has a high percentage of sand, perlite, and the other volcanics, because otherwise it just won't make it. And you're paying, you know, but you can't. And don't put it in the big pot right away. Adjust your pot size to your tree size. So if I was buying one of those little sleeves, I'd start it in a 5-gallon pot. That's what I've got on my driveway right now from the sleeves I got. And again, plant them deep in the pot if you can, and with a little room for mulch in the pot that won't just flow over and outside the pot. Does that make sense? Because they still love their mulch, even though they're potted. And since you have this really well-draining mix, that's half the battle there, that you're not going to get a root rot. Because avocados do require more water than other fruits that you grow, because they like kind of like a cool, moist root zone on that surface, that top foot. So it's different from citrus and stone fruits and those that you kind of let kind of dry before you water again and you drip them and you drip a little deeper, right? They're different. Their roots are close to the surface and need to stay cool and lightly moist. So similar description to planting in a pot. Be very careful with the roots. They're delicate. Add some gypsum in there and leave some room for wood chips and water your tree. I got this from the internet. I thought it was really great. It's a It's a recipe for your own to make your own gritty mix. And you can see if you look at the parts, it calls for sphagnum peat because sphagnum peat, it isn't something that's not like compost. It's very different. It's already ancient. And that's part of the issue too. It's ancient and we're digging it up. But I've seen folks substitute the coir, coconut coir for this too, if you don't want to use the peat. Just be careful because that will start breaking down a lot quicker than the sphagnum does, and you may have to replace it sooner. But you're always going to be monitoring trees and pots for when you need to repot them or replace the soil. So just know that you can use coir. But if you look at the parts, there's three parts of the organic, the coir or the peat, and then the other five parts are either sand, pumice, or perlite. So it's got more gritty stuff in it than it does the loamy stuff. So, and there's an option here. Some folks add a little horticulture or charcoal. I haven't ever done it, but I'm reading up a lot. There's a lot of benefits to having some charcoal in your growing beds or pots or whatever. So watering. They love to have, like I said before, the cool, moist, airy roots. In-ground trees will do well with watering maybe once per week in our summer, occasionally twice per week or more if we have our heat wave 90 plus degree days. Now, I included a table here, and this came from a really excellent website based in Southern California, though, and that's gregalder.com. And I have his link in the back, but he addresses all kinds of issues with avocados, and he does tests, and he has a lot planted on his place. So you can see if you look based on tree size, like a little young tree in the heat of Southern California in July and August, it needs 3 gallons of water, or it needs watering every 3 days, and it needs two and a half, it needs a gallon. A newly planted tree needs a gallon 3 times a week because they're hotter and warmer there. So we have to adjust our watering. I watered way too little when I first started planting avocados, and the trees didn't look like they were water stressed, but they were later to bear and they didn't bear a lot. So definitely, when they get enough water, you will definitely get more fruit, and more growth, better growth. And they may not show it, but and you may have to check. You may have to check. Don't rote. Follow what I've suggested. Your situation, your climate, your exposure to sun, it all may be different. So you have to go out there with your fingers or your water probe and check and look. And knowing that the roots are in that top foot, you have to kind of dig down and dig your fingers in and say, nope, you know what? I think I need a little more frequent watering in my area than this water table tells me, this water chart. So just know that's what you're striving for is moist but not sopping and airy in the top foot of soil. Any questions? Like this year, with all that rain and the winter we had, boy, I didn't start watering. I didn't start taking care of my drips till about, whew, usually I do it in May. This year, I think I was a whole month later. And they were fine. They didn't look like they were suffering. So instead of breaking out all cleaning up my drips and repairing everything in April or May, I did it in May or June this year because we had so much moisture in the soil here.
So we do have one question about watering, and that is, can you
Okay.
deep water? We have two questions actually. Can you deep water avocado trees, deep drip for hours, twice a month, once or twice a month?
No. Because their
No.
roots aren't deep. Their roots aren't deep. They're in the top foot. So it's frequent shallow waterings. That's what avocados want. And doing small deeper waters, like you think you're encouraging those roots to go down, it won't get you the results you want by getting you a more drought tolerant tree, deep rooted. They don't grow that way. So keep your watering the top foot and more frequent. But you can do less because it is a shallow root, right? So not deep, but So you, that's
Okay.
why I'm here to check. Yeah. Okay.
I had a question about those watering rings, drip tube rings. Is that a good way to water an avocado?
Yeah, it's great to water any tree. I use that stuff. I buy the Drip Works, or I forget the different, there's different brands, but they have an emitter every 9 inches or so, and it's a half gallon an hour or something like that. Yeah, and I start with a ring that's little, and I just increase the size of that ring as the tree grows, or I start with a spiral. I maybe cut 10 feet, and I spiral it around this tree and water for a lesser amount of time because there's multiple emitters. And as the tree grows, I just loosen it up and spread it out to go under the canopy. But those rings work really well and they drip down.
Cool. So somebody wants to know how long. So if you're watering twice a week, once or twice a week, how long do you stand there and water it for? Or turn
so
on
you've
your
got to, you've got to know how many gallons are coming out of your faucet or your system. That's the key. It's because length is totally dependent on the volume that's got coming out. So like what this chart shows you, it gives you the gallons per day according to the tree size. So if you look at this chart, a 3 foot tall tree in July needs a gallon. So that's a little baby tree. It needs a gallon and it needs it 3 days a week. So if you have an emitter that's giving off, well, if it's just one emitter giving a half gallon an hour, then you're going to run it 2 hours, I guess, or run it twice, run it 1 hour and then wait a little bit and then water to get another hour. It depends on your soil absorption, right? Heavier soil, it's best to separate your waterings, that volume of water into two lighter waterings to total a gallon rather than give it all at once. That makes sense.
And can I just say, if you water with a hose, you can put it in a 5 gallon bucket and time it.
Yes.
And then, how are
yes.
you doing?
And that's why you make that little tank. So get a bucket, fill it with water, a gallon, put it in your tank and kind of note, oh, goes up the side a little bit before it sucked it right down. I'm going to do, you know, two of these once a week. Or three of these once a week. And again, it depends on your temperature there. If you have warm winds and it's a full sun exposure, you're going to be watering more often than I do. I'm on a kind of a, my whole property's on a slope. It's on the, I get the western sun, but it takes a while for the sun to come up to my property because there's trees behind my property. So I don't have to water as much as for sure as a full sun exposure will. So you always use your fingers and dig down and test and know how deep your water's going. That's how you learn. Because it's you can't just go this chart again. It was based on Southern California, but it's a good place to start and then adjust for our climate and your exposure, your site. Okay. I wish it was easy as to say something that you could just go program it into a timer. It's just not. You have to learn it and then program your timer and always reevaluate that irrigation system because they need to change as the tree grows, right? Your emitters need to spread out. You need to give more water. So you're never stagnant with an irrigation system. Fertilizing, it's up to you, but it's they have similar needs to citrus trees. So you see a lot of times on these bags, you see citrus and avocado fertilizer. If you have access to horse stall cleanings and stuff like that, use what you've got. They don't mind manures. I know somebody who does manures and their trees are thriving. Just make sure it's not, you know, we don't want fresh chicken feet, a chicken manure, of course, you want it composted, but something like horse is mixed with a lot of shaving stuff. It can go right on. And you can feed multiple times a year. I tend to only feed a couple, two, three times a year. I don't feed as much as usually most bags say on the back, I don't know, I think I get enough fruit on my other trees, not overdoing it with the fertilizer, and I'm plenty happy with my citrus and my other fruits. So I tend to kind of underfeed a little bit, as according to a back of a package. That makes any sense. And of course, the back of a package, they want you to put a lot on anyway. But organics are mild, so you can't over fertilize usually with an organic, because they're usually low. Their numbers are low. So when you're first planting and you did it in a mound, and maybe you didn't put hardly any of your native soil in this mound, or you're planting in a pot, especially pots, if you use a potting mix, a few of those potting mixes have mycorrhizae added to the potting mix or the fertilizer to inoculate that container, inoculate the roots of your tree so that it can make use of the fertilizer. These fertilizers, like the down to earth, the doctor earth, you can look on the bag and you can see this long list of bacteria and fungi that are added to the fertilizer or to the soil to inoculate, because these organisms are necessary for your roots of anything you plant to process an organic fertilizer, any fertilizer, but organics too, to break them down, and so they can make use of the nutrients in that fertilizer. And they're in our soil. When you plant in the ground, you don't have to worry about inoculating because they're there. They've been there forever. And they're still there. So, if I just brought this up, if you're planting in a pot, either initially feed with a fertilizer that has them in there, like the down to earths or the doctor earths, or you can buy this inoculant on the side individually, and add it. This mycos, it's look at the back. It's got a long list of organisms in there that are all beneficial to the roots of your tree to help it process and help it make best use of the fertilizer you give it. Okay, here's the most important thing. One of the most important things you need to do with this avocado tree. It's just a baby. It was grown either in a greenhouse or under a hoop shade. You can't just put it out in the sun. It gets sunburnt, just like a little. Just think of you're exposing an infant to the sun when you plant this tree. Think about it that way. It will burn. And you see this, these are some of the signs. You'll see the shoulders of the branches. You'll see the trunks get just turn dark brown or black. And it burns the tissue down inside the branch or limb. So the limb can die if it burns long enough and deep enough. The limb or the trunk can die. So until it gets a couple years old where it has a nice leafy canopy, you've got to protect the tree, the young baby tree, from sun. And here they put some of this black shade cloth over the top. That works well. Here they painted the stem and the branches with a 50-50 mix of just simple, basic, flat white latex paint, interior paint. 50-50 with water. I keep a canning jar of it, and I just shake it up, and that's what I paint on my trees so they don't get sunburned. That's their sunscreen. This product, it works very well. It's kind of costly, but you can go in on it with somebody else. It's just kale and clay. It's like what we put in our facial clay mask to clean our pores out. It's kaolin and really finely ground, and you mix it with water and spray it on, and it looks white like this. But it goes on the leaves and on the tree and protects it from the sun. So that's something you could use too if you have access to it. This white Rime that people use in their veggie gardens and stuff to keep off bugs and to protect young plants, that can also shade it from the sun. And it also gives frost protection too. So when we talk about frost, you may have something like this protecting you. Giving you a couple degrees of protection from the cold. And there's some folks that just put an umbrella, a beach umbrella or something, over their baby tree. And it's just at the topmost when the sun's highest in the sky, right? So it's getting sun when the sun comes low up and over, and it's getting sun again later in the day. But the peak hours, it's covering it up. And it looks like it still has its trunk painted white in addition to that umbrella. So whatever works for you to shade your tree, it needs to have it. It's very important. Likewise, protecting your tree from the cold. 30 to 32 degrees on that baby tree. Watch the weather. When we're going to have cold nights, be ready with a frost blanket, or some people use incandescent light strings. These are patio lights or Christmas lights, the old-fashioned kind that screw in or get warm. LEDs won't work here because they don't generate heat. So a simple blanket like this, even just over the top, this can help you with 2 or 3 degrees of cold because the frost comes down from up and there's still warmth coming up from the ground under here. So that may be enough for a bigger tree that you can't get to all parts of it to cover it down to the ground. Your best protection, of course, and especially in younger, is when you can cover the whole tree down to the ground. With your maximum protection, the whole tree down to the ground with lights inside. If it's going to get that cold for your tree, maybe you're in an area that just gets too cold for this variety of avocado. And you can maybe look for one that can take 18 degrees or 24 degrees. Just saying. I know our weather's changing and we're not hitting these low temps anymore, but that still doesn't mean you can go buy a tree geared more for the tropics when you're in an area that gets down to 20 degrees in the winter.
Can I pop in for a second before you go to
Yeah.
painting? So some we're getting some questions about, do you cover it when it's, do you cover it with burlap to keep the sun off it so it doesn't sunburn? Do you is it the temperature that's the problem, or is it the solar exposure that's a problem?
It's both. It's UV. It's just like we can get, humans can get sunburn on a cloudy day. So it's because we're either fair to begin with, or we haven't been had a lot of exposure to sun, and we don't have a lot of tan buildup in our skin, and we're going to turn red before we turn brown. So if you look in this upper corner, this is a shade cloth, that black cloth. You can get it at hardware stores, gardening supplies, and it'll have different numbers, but mostly you see something like, oh, it blocks out 50% of the sun or 30% of the sun. It has a number that indicates the percentage of sun that infiltrates through it. So for sun, if you're going to do something like burlap, which I think of more of a solid, then do more of a little piece like this umbrella. That's more like what they did with burlap. They didn't cover the whole thing because your tree still needs sun. But that's why these are so effective, like this spray. It just gives an overall SPF 15 or something, It's like when you put zinc oxide on your skin, right? This one is like when you put on a shirt. They painted the whole trunk and branch. You put on a shirt to block the sun. So they painted that and left the leaves open to the sun. So if in our area here, it's more just the rays of the sun initially, when that tree has nothing to cover its limbs. So for the first year at least, until it grows more leaves, get something like the black shade cloth in the corner that is like a mesh. It's not like burlap, it's a mesh. And let's light three. Or you see this white rime here, it's like a spun bond polyester. You can find that at garden supplies and online too. And it transmits a certain percentage of light, but doesn't block light. So something like that would work too. So we're looking at still letting the light come through, all the while protecting the vulnerable areas like trunk and bare limbs. Now, in Southern California, when it gets really hot, they're not only watching for when it gets cold in the winter, but in the summer, if it's going to get 90 degrees, they may go take something out to that frame they have around their tree, like a shade cloth or burlap, to shade the tree because it's an extra heat wave coming on. And that maybe not will kill the tree, but it will toast a lot of the leaves. They can may get a lot of leaf burn from heat, a 90-degree day. So
And a
here, I'd say
segue
we're
to
looking.
your, I'm
Go
sorry.
ahead. No, go ahead.
I just wanted to segue you into pruning. if you've gotten burn, either frost burn or sunburn, do you trim off that part of the plant? What do you do with it?
Yeah, you will just wait till the season's over, like the frosty cold season. Wait till you're way past the last frost date and trim off everything that looked turned black. It was several years ago. My trees were young. I had my first fruit sets on some of the good ones. They were little trees, and we got a deep cold, and I didn't protect enough. We got down to an aroma here was like 20, and it wasn't just one night of 27. It was two or three nights of like 26, 27 degrees. They were young trees, so the trees didn't die, but I had to cut a lot off later. But all the fruit turned black and fell off. The fruit froze, and a lot of the growth had to be cut off. So it set the tree back a year or two, fruiting wise, 2 years back at least. So wait to prune, because even dead branches are protection against further frost. And if it was from the heat, and if it was only the leaves, they will fall off on their own. You can just let the tree will shed the burnt leaf.
Okay.
You can leave it. Because as
Okay.
I say later, the avocado tree, don't be a neatnik and rake up all the falling leaves. That drops a lot of leaves every year. Leave them as its own mulch. It likes its own leaves to mulch itself.
All righty. So time check at 6 o'clock, and you're doing great because you've answered a whole lot of questions. So party on.
Okay. So, as far as pruning, you don't have to prune a tree at all, the avocado at all. It'll grow huge, tall, wide. It may have a little a broader than tall shape. Varieties are like that. Some varieties are tall and narrow, some are short and squat. But I included some shapes here because these little basic shapes, kind of more vase-like, or a little more of a central leader type, like what you see on, apples and pears, or this kind of wide vase, like you see more on peaches. All this does, it's just a suggestion because it's just trying to let in a little more light to the lower branches. The avocado tree itself will grow so wide and it'll shade its lower branches. So if you prune a little bit to let a little more light on the lower branches, you'll get fruit on those lower, more fruit on the lower branches. Instead of, if you don't prune at all, you tend to see the fruit go, it's up and out, right? Because it's on the new growth and that's on the taller end of the tree, and even new growth that comes from the inner limbs, if it doesn't get enough sun, it won't bear. So you can lightly prune to give yourself a shape that'll let a little more light into your lower branches, and that's all this is for. You don't have to go every year and prune, and especially a baby tree, don't prune at all unless it has one weird branch that's sticking out and hanging low or something. Go ahead and shorten it and then protect it from sun. But in general, you don't need to prune that baby for a few years. And then after that, your pruning is really going to be to keep it to the size that you need to keep it to for your yard and for your access to the fruit.
And could you talk a little bit more about that? If the fruit is born on new wood and you want to keep it short and you prune it to keep it short, where's the trade-off there?
Well, if you just top it from the top, you're going to still have new growth on the sides. So you've just maybe taken off some of what won't grow on the top that next season. But it's just like anything else, like peaches that grow on what the previous year's growth, right? When you prune, you don't cut everything off. You don't lollipop it, right? Because you're cutting off all the new growth. And then the next year, everything that grew the previous year, there's no blooms on it or very few because you evenly cut all that new growth off. So it's the same thing. You're just going to be mindful when you do prune. Don't do it from sides and top. Maybe just choose one thing that year, sides or top. Narrow it or top it so that you can get fruit on that other part of it the next year. Does that make sense? It's just a general guideline. Just don't try to do it all in 1 year. Just monitor as it and know that you want to leave some growth for blooming the next year.
And I've been hearing a couple times here. Do you need to pick off the fruit the first year, like a strawberry?
It's rare that it sets fruit before it can hold it, but you do have some precocious varieties. Reed, people tend to pluck that one because it tends to set fruit a little too young. I'd say lamb may do that. If your tree is real tiny and it happened to set a lot of fruit, one, you're lucky. Maybe you got a good tree that, or you have the right local pollinators, and or you're lucky. But yes, you may have to if it oversets. I think it's not too much of an issue, but you don't have to pluck everything off that first year. I doubt, honestly, I doubt if you will. If you happen to, maybe I should make a call and say pluck them off, but it's pretty rare. The tree holds, and I'd give it a chance to drop on its own. They do a lot of self dropping of fruit that they can't hold. And you might be very disappointed because you saw a good bloom and you saw all these little babies all over growing little baby fruits. And then the next month, all those little babies turned brown and fell off, you know, the little fruits, because it knew what it can't handle and it just self-dropped. So don't go out there and do it right away. Wait till the fruit's about the size of a big stuffed olive. And then if it's a baby tree, yeah, one of those with pimentos in it, and it's a baby tree, go pinch them off and close your eyes and pinch them off. But it's going to be a rare occasion that that happens, but I've read about it happening a little bit, but it's not as vital as it is like when you first plant a citrus tree. That'll kind of stunt it for 2 years if you let that first crop bear when you just planted it and it had all those fruit on it when you transplanted it, and then it just sits there for 2 years. It's not quite the same thing. So here I tried to show an example where somebody they were pruning and they were trying to do cut back to a lateral branch, this first example. And they cut right at the collar, that place where it's thick at the base where the branch adjoins the trunk. There's a little thickened collar around the branch. So when you cut, leaving a little bit of collar, that collar heals over the cut. That's what stone fruits do and stuff like that. They heal over. So that was good. And then it had the desired effect. Here's the new growth that shot out underneath your pruning. But then here's the similar thing. Look at this one. They pruned up here, and it didn't shoot out new growth underneath it. This whole kind of thing kind of just fizzled out. The new growth came under here. This was the new growth from that pruning. It whoops, whoops, sorry. And it shot up. It's already a little older now, but and that thing just kind of withered up because this has taken all the juice, all the energy and stuff. So what's further up the tree from this big energy sucking branch, you're just gonna have to cut it off anyway. So they don't always do what you want. Avocados, like I say, they can shoot off from anywhere. They're not bound to crotches or nodes. But you can try to make a nice clean cut, nice clean tools, sharp tools, and cut on a collar to get a heel over, and then see what happens. A lot of times that might induce some this weird vertical water spout, a vertical shoot comes up. They do that a lot from prunings. And you may have to either keep it or trim that vertical down and to get it to side branch. But they're fun. They're just so vigorous once they get big enough to where your pruning has effect and they just want to grow after they've been pruned. They find a place to grow. But again, if you make extensive cuts or you cut, this one was cut and it left this whole lower part exposed, whitewash it. Okay, so here's some of the things that can happen with your tree, and you can see this with other fruit trees. It happens a lot with citrus, and folks don't even know it's going on, it's happening, but you get the rootstock takes over. You either get suckers coming up from the ground or from under the root, under the graft scar, like this one. Here's the fruiting tree that was grafted. Here's the scar where it was grafted onto the rootstock. But this growing up on the side is the start of a rootstock sucker. And if allowed to grow, it can just get really huge. The tree will favor that over this, and it can overtake your tree. This will suffer, not fruit. And this will get really huge. And that's what happened down here, or what's starting to happen. The smaller leaves are the original fruit-bearing tree that was grafted onto the rootstock. This, I believe, came from the ground, this big, vigorous guy. And people think, oh, my tree's growing. It's so vigorous. I'm doing everything right. Whenever you see growth like that, trace it. Trace it down to its source. If it's coming from below the graft scar, cut it off. If it's coming from the ground, cut it off. Even try to dig it out a little bit if you can, but cut it off for sure. Because all it's doing is taking energy you want to grow in your good fruit-bearing part of your tree. Okay? People want to let this grow to get two varieties on their tree. Since it is the rootstock, it's a little different than a tree grafted with two onto a different rootstock. It will always favor this tree, and you may not get the greatest fruit from it because this rootstock was chosen for its disease-resistant properties, its cold hardiness, and you may not get anything that's superior for sure to the one you bought. So it's best to cut it off. Unless that's the only thing that's left. If this dies, if your good tree dies because it just couldn't survive, but the rootstock sprouted up later, which happens a lot when an avocado, a baby tree dies, the tree will sprout back up the next year. You think it's dead and gone, and there you see a tree growing. You can let that grow and then graft or have it grafted and graft a good variety onto that strong rootstock again. So you can opt to do that if there isn't anything else growing. So I'm going to go over some commonly asked questions that I'd see in the nursery and I see online. And there's a lot of information out there that is confusing. And the first one is, do I need two trees for pollination? I see it everywhere. Oh, you need to get, they call them males and females, but they're really A's and B's. Do I need an A and a B? And they'll list a tree and list it if it's an A or a B, so you can be sure you get an A and sure you get a B. But the short answer to that for us here is no. Don't get caught up in that. If you only have room for one tree, it's better you get a good bearing A, a tasty A for your area than make room and get a B. The B's in general in our area, they're okay fruit, but they're nowhere near as good as the A's in general for us here. If you have a choice, just get an A. Or if you only can get two A's and get an A that ripens earlier and an A that ripens later. So you have a longer spread over ripening. So you have avocados for longer rather than waste that space and get an inferior B. And that's just my general advice. And the whole A and B thing, if you want a little know a little more detail, is each avocado has the ability that the flowers open one sex. They open either female, an A opens as a female in the morning, closes later than in an afternoon of the next day, it opens male. So that same flower has both sexes in it. Now, what it in a really ideal climate in Guatemala or Puebla, where these things evolved, that opening and closing is very distinct. So on one tree, and that's, on one tree, since it's female in the morning and then it closes, it's female for a few hours, it closes, then the next day in the afternoon it opens male, you can see where it's not going to pollinate itself if it's very distinct. And that maybe was, evolutionary for, so it wouldn't inbreed. It had to have other trees nearby, so it got cross-pollinated, right? So, but here, with the varieties that are out there, and with our cool climate, that opening and closing, it isn't distinct. So we have male and females open at the same time on our trees. That's true for Southern Cal too, but especially true here. You don't need two different trees to get fruit. What is way more important is you have the right pollinators around to get that pollen when it is open as a male and be able to pollinate the female tree, the female blossom, I should say, or when she's in her female stage. And it's pretty easy to tell. You can see the female here. She's got that little round belly. That's the ovule in there. And if it's an A tree, she opens female first in the morning and then later the day closes and then opens up with all these little pollen anthers, male covering ovule. So if you have something crawling around in there, that little female is going to get pollinated.
Hey, Loretta,
Hello?
I want to give you
Yes.
time to. We've got 15
Okay.
minutes.
Okay. Any other questions on A and B? Don't read the signs in the nurseries that say you need two. They're trying to sell you an inferior tree that isn't going to bear for you. That's the other thing. Most of the good bees, Forte, you've heard about Forte. It's one of the original great tasting avocado, buttery, delicious. I've gotten four avocados on my tree over the last 12 years. It needs a warm, dry spring to pollinate, and that doesn't happen here very often. Don't waste your money. The other bees, bacon is a good bee that bears well here. It's just not as tasty. If I could replace my bacon with something else, I still may, but I leave it there because I do get something from it. I get good or a good amount of avocados. They're just not that tasty. So, and here's some of the commonly asked questions. Well, why does then if I don't need the A and B, then why am I not getting fruit? So pollination for trees that bloom are difficult, right? So the honeybees, you see them on this picture, but they don't really favor avocado. It's a sticky, bitter pollen, from what I read. They're even seen cleaning it off their legs before they go back into the hive. But they will visit. I've seen them visiting. If you have citrus trees blooming nearby, they're going to be at the citrus and not come to your avocados. I see ants crawling on mine. That's a good thing. I don't treat for ants. I let them crawl all over. You get flies, house flies, and these other little syrphid flies. There, I see those more than honeybees on my avocado blossoms when they're in bloom. I added this little blurb here about one presentation I saw down south, a very reputable nurseryman. He did an experiment. He sprayed honey water, one part honey to four parts water, on a branch of a tree to attract more honeybees for pollination, and he said he got more fruit on that branch. So it's something I will try. It's something to try. Maybe not the whole tree, but try a branch and see if you think if it made any difference to you with the honeybees coming to pollinate those blooms. And if it's a matter of if your tree doesn't bloom, and that's your question, why isn't it bearing fruit? Then review the variety selected. Where you have it planted, does it get enough sun? Is it warm enough? Is it getting water and fertilizer? If it's not blooming, there's something else wrong if it's already a few years old and not blooming. Seedling trees, people who plant the seedling from the bowl of guacamole they made the night before, they're great. They're so fun. The tree grows out of the pit. You put it in a cup of water, but you're going to take a lot longer for those trees to bear the seedlings. And you may or may not get a better variety. You will maybe have a 50 to 75% chance you will get fruit on that seedling tree, and maybe it's good and maybe it's not. So that's your chances, but it's fun to grow them, and you can always grow them, and if they're vigorous, graft onto them. Okay, this is another good question. When are they ready to pick? The best avocado varieties hang on the tree over a year, up to from 14 to 16, 18 months, they may be hanging on the tree. So don't think that at the end of the year you have to go pick this fruit because your trees are in the spring, it's blooming again, and there's still fruit hanging on your tree that are green. They need to hang longer. So, how can you tell when to pick? See how glossy this first picture is. When it's hanging on the tree and they're young and don't have the oil content in them yet, they're glossy and hard. They're always going to be hard, but they're glossy. See this middle one here? It's dull. It's lost its glossiness, and you see the stems have turned yellow. That might be one to try. Pick one, bring it inside, and if it gets ripe in a week or two and tastes good to you, then it's ready to pick. And then do another experiment. Maybe you only have a few. This is a young tree. You have three avocados. Don't pick them all at first. Let's see how long they hang on your tree. So wait a few months. Wait as long as you can to pick those last one or two. So you can come up with a time frame for your tree and your location as to when you can first start picking it and how long they're good for. And also, depending on the variety, lamb hass is a really good one to have. It's precocious, it bears a lot, bears young, and it turns black. It gives you a good color indicator. And it's still hard, but I'm trying one now. It looks like it's softening up. I picked it at 3/4 black, and it's taking about 2+ weeks to ripen up. So maybe I like it better when it's all black and it only takes 1 to 2 weeks to ripen. The longer it hangs on the tree, the more oil and nuttiness it gets on it from the tree. So it'll taste better, usually, the longer it hangs than those first ones you pick. Any questions? So this,
There are both questions actually. Let's
okay.
handle them now. There was one person who planted a seed years ago, and now it's 30 feet tall, and it's hardly ever borne a fruit. So that's sad. And the bacon, you say it does well, but I've had several people on the call say that their bacon trees aren't really producing. One person wants to know if you can hand pollinate. That's a good one.
You can try, you can, but here's the deal too. It isn't just one grain to get on the stigma of that female ovule to pollinate her. She needs like over 10 grains. That's why avocados, they bear millions of blossoms, but only like 0.03 or 0.001% of them will pollinate because it's just a difficult thing. You have the right pollinators, and they got to get a lot of grains of pollen on that stigma to get it to pollinate, to keep so it doesn't, so it grow keeps growing the fruit, because it may start growing a little bit and then it'll just shrivel up and fall off, and it didn't get enough pollen grains. So you can, but it's not easy. Keep doing it, do it every day, multiple times, put a little fan, try to get paintbrushes. You'd have to research all the different ways people do, or try to attract the right pollinators to do it for you. And if you, those that had the bacon tree, yeah, that was my heaviest bear, and that kept me in guacamole when the cold toasted my Hass that had fruit. The bacon wasn't damaged at that low temp several years ago, and even though the fruit isn't the greatest, when that's all you have, you just spice it up and you eat the guacamole anyway. It's good. You add plenty of spices, and it was good.
Okay.
Now that I'm getting some other stuff, I leave them for last. They get better as they hang longer, but if yours isn't bearing, look at your site, your watering. Remembering that they need more water than you think. Even though the tree may look good, it needs more water to bear.
Any nutritional reasons it wouldn't bear?
You'd probably see that in the leaves, but give it some fertilizer a couple times a year. If it was deficient in any specific nutrient you'd see in the leaves, and it's not just dropping leaves. I talk about that later. They will drop their leaves, but if you see other signs of disease, if you see blackening branches, blackening trunk, then it's got something. Or you see borers going into the holes in the trunk with sap oozing out. That might be why it isn't bearing. It's ill. So check it out to see if everything else is healthy. And if it is, feed it and water it a little more and see if that makes a difference next year.
Okay, and before we lose time, we've got 5 more minutes. How big should a gopher basket be if you're going to use one?
Enough to give you know, a few inches on either side. Like when I planted a sleeve, I used a 5 gallon gopher basket in a sleeve because it will go through the grow through them just fine. Both my citrus, I had my doubts about those things, but they grow through them and they grow big enough to where the gopher doesn't kill them anymore. But I have had gophers get avocados that we didn't have that were unprotected, so they will go for them. They're not hungry for them like they are if you have a fig tree or something, but they'll go for them. So if you are planting a 5 gallon tree, I would get a 10 gallon basket, gopher basket.
Okay, that sounds
Not
good.
just a 5 gallon, even though the 5 gallon gopher basket gives you a few inches around a 5 gallon pot, go bigger because you're going to want a bigger hole because you want to loosen that, make a nice, loose, friable soil.
How much growth do you expect a tree to put on each year in terms of diameter and
It
just
depends
from
on the variety, the vigorous varieties. If you're feeding and watering properly in Southern California, I've seen those trees in 1 year. A little 3 foot sapling is 6 foot tall. That's ideal climate, of course. That's really warm weather and watering and feeding. You do want to see a good amount of growth every year, especially with the baby trees. If you don't see hardly anything at all, there's something wrong in the soil or with the nutrition or with watering or ill. But you should see, they're vigorous. At least, I would say, at least gauge yourself on getting a good 2 feet that first year from your baby tree if you plant it in the spring. If it's planted later, no, then wait for next year to get that kind of growth. If you plant in the fall.
All right. Tragically, we're almost out of time. So, can you click through your commonly asked questions and let's.
People say, when is my seedling going to bear? They have a sentimental tree that their son planted and brought home from kindergarten, and it isn't bearing. It can take a while, but it will bear. 5 to 10 years average for a seedling to fruit. And then it's a toss-up whether you like the fruit or not, but you can get fruit and it may be good.
When's the
So,
best time to plant here in Santa Cruz?
spring after, when it's not so cold, maybe after the worst of the rains are over, I would say do it then. Plant then when it's warmer, drying up a little bit. You can easier to dig without compacting your soil or anything. Or in the fall, I'd say you can plant. I'm going to plant some in the fall. Avoid the hot season. Not like we always have one, but look at the weather. If we're going to have continuous in the 80s or something or high 70s, I wouldn't do then. But if it's normal for us, it's 68 and it's going to be 68 all month or something, go ahead and just put your shade up anyway and watch your watering and your shade. It's a lot more of an issue where it's hotter down in south to avoid the summer.
Alrighty.
So yeah, when will it bear? It's better to graft a known great avocado to that seedling. If you have a seedling that's growing vigorously but just isn't bearing, or you don't like the fruit, you can cut it down. They stump trees and regraft all the time. You can have a big mature tree. Somebody talked about a big tree that wasn't bearing. You can cut it. Just leave a couple feet. Just cut it, and it'll induce all these sprouts to come out of the trunk. And then don't do it now. I'd say latest to do it is summertime. Do it in the spring or summer, so you have all year for it to grow, and then you can graft onto it the next spring.
Okay.
If you stumped it now, I'm not sure if you'd have a good enough growth with what remains in the growing season now to give you something hefty to graft on, a good sprout to graft on next spring.
Okay. What else you got?
The last one, why is it losing leaves? This worries people. Because the leaves will just start turning yellow, then brown, and fall off. And it's usually in the time between, you'll start seeing blooms starting to form on your tree. And then the tree starts dropping leaves and leaves those blooms kind of almost naked. That's just natural. People try to overwater or feed or fertilize, and that's natural. They have a leaf drop. Some trees drop more than others, and some seasons your tree's going to drop more. So let them drop and let them mulch the tree. Watch if so many drop that it leaves limbs exposed if it's really young. And you may have to go and whitewash something because it drops so many trees that you see exposed tips or exposed limbs. So just watch it, but that's normal. And again, leave those dropped leaves to mulch the tree.
Okay. All right. Quick click of any. A few things that are coming up at the UCSC Center for Agroecology through the Friends of the Farm and Garden. We've got some classes happening, and a free garden guided tour of the farm is happening on the 3rd. We have research findings for a new no-till research project that was done as a PhD project. It's going to be good. That's available online and in person. That's happening September 6th. And I believe that's free. Our annual farm and garden annual Harvest Festival, which is a great thing for kids and others, is happening on the 14th, and we're going to have some master gardeners teaching classes at that on natives and other topics. And then in the winter, we are putting together, hopefully we're going to have a wreath making class and a food preservation class, was a big hit last year. Next. And the master gardeners are doing things too. So they are starting up their every 2 years master gardener certification program. There's an information session coming up day after tomorrow, if you'd like to do that. Another one's happening in September. So if you love gardening and you want to learn more and you want training in it, and then you want to give back to the community, it's a great thing to do. And then we have some classes coming. There's a virtual support series on vegetable gardening for beginners, and look for classes in tool care, succulents this winter. We've got a composting one-on-one happening soon. And a soils class is happening in September. So look for those on the Master Gardener website. And our fall plant sale is happening October 9th to 15th. And Loretta has, a lot of you have asked, where do I get them? Where do I get my wonderful avocado trees? So she's given us resources. You want to click through? Great tips and places to buy. You want to talk about Epicenter?
Yeah. So you can get your typical varieties in most nurseries. They have good stock. A lot of them come from our local Four Winds growers in Watsonville. Lots come through other growers. If you're looking for something a little different that will still grow here, rare or local, there's a lot of local seedlings that bear. And there's a couple that live in La Selva Beach locally. They grow the avocados there to make sure they will do well in our area. But they have their own avocado tree nursery called Epicenter. They open like the first of the year. You can go online and look at this website. You can look at the website now. It describes the varieties, some of them where they found them. And you can start ordering at the beginning of the year. They don't have it open for ordering now, and they usually sell out in a month. So if you're looking at their varieties and you want to find something that you can't find in a nursery, for the most part, go to Epicenter. They're also the gurus on avocados in our climate. They grow in a La Selva Beach is even a little cooler than me. Cooler than I am, and they have great success. So, because they're closer to the coast and they get some more, a little colder, also they're a low coastal area there. So, then our other local grower, Four Winds, is based out of Watsonville. Ooh, and I put Epicenter. I will have to fix that. I should have put Four Winds there, not Epicenter. I just caught that. So, they sell all kinds of, you know, they specialize in citrus. But they do have a good selection of avocados. And in the spring, you can order all kinds of stone fruits and figs and pomegranates from them too. If you're going to plant a lot of trees or what people do, Broca, we have one of the premier commercial supplier of roots of avocado trees to the industry, to commercial growers. But a lot of times, home growers, they do a buy-in together because you may have to buy 20 trees. But they have special root stocks, and that's something I'd like to try to get a hold of just to see if they do better here. But you know, they have this clonal root stock, which is you get consistent rather than a seedling root stock that kind of all behave the same but aren't genetically exactly the same. A clonal root stock is the same all along. So they have a lot of those that they've been testing and piloting and they're grafting trees on. So they're in Central Coast, like either Ventura or in that area out there, I think. So they're another resource for trees if you get a buy-in with somebody or you're going to have a grove. Here's some good internet resources for you. You can ask me questions. There's my internet address, my mail, email. We have the hotline for our local Monterey Santa Cruz chapter of the Master Gardeners has a hotline. And you could submit questions about anything you're growing, right? And with pictures, if what's this disease? What's eating my plant? Why isn't it thriving, et cetera? That's a good resource for you. And you can also go to the Monterey Bay chapter of the California Rare Fruit Growers. They're online and they have tabs that have varieties of fruits of different variety kinds, avocados, stone fruits, citrus that grow well here. So if you're trying to grow something that's doesn't like our cool, moist climate, check their website and see if they have the fruit you're looking for in the variety that will do well for you here. Greg Alder, this website, he's in Southern California. I can't recommend this site enough. I just go in there and read blogs and read discourse between readers that come and ask questions and he answers. But he's done a lot of research on avocados. There's a lot of information on watering, planting, diseases, recognizing deficiencies by looking at leaves. A very good site. Just keep in mind they're warmer than we are. So when they talk about they're already ripening or they're already blooming and you're not, it's because we're north. So just keep that in mind. But everything else is just really great. Highly recommend it. Another resource good to know is, we have a local commercial grower of avocados in Watsonville or Corralitos, and that's Bobcat Ridge. And, he takes a lot of produce, but his primary focus is avocados, but he grows all kinds of other fruits and vegetables that he takes to the Corralitos market. Farmers market. So if you subscribe to his newsletter, every week you see what avocados he's got for sale. So I use that as kind of a gauge to know, wow, this variety is still available. It's bearing, it's hanging on the trees there a long time. Or okay, this one's all gone, and now maybe I'm going to plant this one because, it's a later ripening fruit. So it's a good reference just to know everything that's ripening and. If it's sellable that time of the year, you can grow it and have it for yourself that time of the year, right?
All right, Loretta, we're going to have to wrap up. I want to just say that Loretta had a lot more slides on pests, diseases, and deficiencies that are going to be available to you. And we put them in the back, just assuming that you're going to have the best possible luck. But that information is all also going to be available to you. So thank you all so much for being here. Thank you, Loretta, for an amazing
Good
presentation.
luck. I
And
wish you success. I want you to succeed. So treat that avocado tree like it's a naked baby.
because it kind of is, and you got to paint it and diaper it and everything. All
Feed it,
right.
flip it, change it, clothe it, protect it from the
Right.
sun. Yeah.
Thanks, everybody. And we will, you'll be hearing from us by email. We'll send you all these resources and information. Hope to see you on the next class. Take care.
Bye.